My name's Kelvin Montagu, and I'll be hosting this integrated crop protection webinar. So welcome along, and the process will be we'll have a presentation from Paul and Marc on my left, and then we'll take some questions from you. I just want to first acknowledge the integrated crop protection program is a national program that's funded from Horticultural Innovation Australia, from vegetable levy funds and the federal government. Hopefully many of you will be aware of the integrated crop protection program and soil wealth, and have come along to many of our events, our farm walks, previous webinars, masterclasses, or have accessed the resource material from the website. And I think in the email that's been sent out, you've got links. So there's plenty of information there, and particularly in relation to weeds, there's a weed tab that you can go and find a fact sheet that is based around today's presentation. And also, in about a week's time, there'll be a recording of this webinar. Paul, can you just click on the questions? I just want to run you through the question process. We allow quite a bit of time for questions, so we'd like to see them coming in. Has Paul, can you advance that slide?
Yep. Oops.
So on your screen, you'll hopefully see a yellow arrow, and then if you click on that, if it's has shrunk down, if you click on it, that'll open up a control panel, and then you'll see questions on that. If you type in your questions, they'll come through to us. At the end of the presentation, my role will be to aggregate those questions up and ask either Marc or Paul to have a crack at answering those. If we don't get round to your question, we will endeavour to provide a written response. So I'd like to now introduce you to Paul Kristiansen and Marc Hinderager. Paul's from the University of New England, and he's up in Armidale at the moment. So this is our first multi-site webinar, so hopefully it all should go well. And of course, I've got Marc right next to me here. Paul, I'll hand over to you now to start the presentation.
Great, thanks very much, Kelvin. I just noticed there's a couple of questions coming through about the feedback, so maybe mute one of the mics, and maybe mute your mic in Sydney and be mine going here in Armidale. I'll leave that to Liam to sort out. So, yep, hi everyone out there in webinar world. So what we wanted to do today was really to sort of to go through the ideas about integrated weed management. So myself, so Paul Kristiansen, I've been working with Michael Coleman and Chris Fife and a colleague, Brian Sindel, here at UNE on a few different horticulture projects looking at weed management in the vegetable industry and what people are doing, what are the problematic weeds and so on. So it's sort of summarising those ideas and then giving highlighting how integrated weed management or IWM might work in a vegetable situation. So, yep, thanks to UNE, thanks to ICP and also Hort Innovation Australia for allowing us to run around the country and talk to farmers and so on. So off we go. So yeah, we really want to, so I'll start with what the key thing is about integrated weed management that we want to talk about. And really these are the principles down here: plan, do and review. Be diverse in what you do, whether that's over the longer, you know, over 1 or 2 years in terms of your rotations, or what you're doing in terms of how you're managing weeds and, you know, rotating the methods, rotating the herbicides. Avoiding patterns. Weeds, pest diseases love patterns. They love you to do the same thing and create a regular environment for them. So we want to avoid that. Diligence and timing are other key ones. So getting on top of it early when the weeds are younger and easier to control. Obviously, you know, certain timing in terms of the soil not too wet, not too dry, very important as well. So the timing of the operations. And being diligent, yeah, getting in early when they're much easier to control. And then overarching all of that is hygiene. So, and we'll talk about these things sort of a few times up again and again in this talk to sort of say, you know, it's really about trying to manage the, not just the weeds that you can see, but the weeds that are below ground in the seed bank. So things like hygiene, think crop rotation, reducing the seed banks, breaking cycles, plastic mulch, so that's obviously a very, very useful tool, depending on the type of crop you're growing, maybe common for some and not used at all in others. So, but very effective, but has its own issues. Early control, getting in early to control that, whichever technique, herbicides or cultivation, backing it up with hand weeding, and then obviously herbicides is a key thing. So let's sort of go on, and weeds definitely have a significant impact, whether it's the cost, that direct cost in terms of management and the cost of herbicides, the labour involved to apply them or to chip or to plough and preparing and so on. So there's a lot of direct costs associated with weed management. On the other side, it's the reduction in yield, so they're competing for resources, soil, water, nutrients, and so on. So they're going to reduce the yield, potentially. They also, what might interfere with the sowing and harvesting, so the various farming operations can be made more difficult, less efficient, and so on, by having the weeds there, creating a bit more work for the farmers. Again, weeds can have effect on the quality. So there may be contamination in some things. They may mark certain plants and particularly leafy vegetables and so on. So that, again, reducing your income there and the amount of rejected crop material. Sort of indirectly, they can act as hosts for certain pests and diseases. So again, control of them can be very important so that you're not bringing other baddies along with the system. And then finally, weeds potentially have we don't know a lot about resistance of, weed resistance to herbicides in vegetable production. There's a fair bit of information about that in the broadacre industries. We don't know too much about that, but we certainly don't want to lose the effectiveness of the herbicides that we have available to us. So again, that sort of harks back to the need for an integrated approach to weed management. Economic impact. So yeah, again, it can range. So in terms of so it can range from fairly high, a quarter of the variable costs. So this is some data from the New South Wales DPI. It can range from quite high, quarter of the costs for these sort of vegetables with very small canopies that aren't very competitive, through to other ones, much less, things like capsicum, maybe they're grown under plastic and that's more efficient. These costs don't include labour, so these were just the direct costs for things like herbicides and maybe the plastic. So include labour and then, you know, your costs have gone up a lot more. So they're a big part, as you all know, of the costs of farming vegetables. So there's a couple of questions. So we'll save these till the end, and then we'll hopefully have half an hour at the end to have a bit of a chat and address some of the questions about the costs. So what are the important weeds? What are the bit of the devil you know? So what are we dealing with here? So some of the work that I've done with the group here is traveling around Australia, putting the growers, agronomists, the chemical companies and so on, and asking them what are the important weeds. Often it comes down to not so many. There's some really key problematic weeds and then a few others as well. And a lot of them are pretty common across all states. There are some that maybe only occur in the north, like up in the Territory, some down in Tassie and so on. But they tend to be fairly common through a wide range of areas. So, I'll talk in a minute about some specifics, but what are we thinking about? Why are these, what are the really problematic weeds in vegetable production? So it's the heavy seeding annuals, those ones that they're very quick, we call it precocious. So they grow very quickly, they flower, set seed, shed their seed very quickly and in really high numbers. So they're adapted to that annual cropping cycle and they're very quick. And they've got their seeds back into the ground before, you know, potentially before you've had time to manage them. So heavy seeding annuals, very common, and you know, whenever you disturb ground, they're the first things that pop up as well. Some ground that's been not disturbed for a while. So the next big group are the biennials and perennials, so the longer lived ones that have some persistent underground parts. So it might be roots, corms, runners, rhizomes, all those sort of things that tough it out underground and then they'll sprout up again. There's not really seeds, but they're persisting with some sort of underground parts. Another difficult one, it's difficult to control them, things like tillage, tends to just break them up and drag them around the paddock and spread them. Often herbicides are difficult to, or ineffective or less effective, because they're not translocating through the plant. Spray the leaves and they don't go right. They'll only kill up to the next node or the next joint, and then that's all. So they're difficult in that sense. Also, other species difficult to control in terms of the leaf. There may be a hairy leaf or a waxy leaf and so on. So they tend to be some of the characteristics. Again, you could tick the boxes on all these criteria and may not be a weed, but certainly these are the common themes. The other issue too is that for vegetables, not many vegetables are in the grass family. So we're really sort of focusing on broadleaf herbicide. We've got broadleaf crop and broadleaf weeds. So that can be problematic in trying to get selective herbicides where the weeds are related to the crop. So there's a lot of brassicaceae weeds, so weeds in the brassica family. There's a lot of vegetables too. And in the Asteraceae as well. So there's issues there, same with the carrot family too. So that close relationship makes it difficult to get effective herbicides that will be selective. So some of the problem weeds, and these are all familiar to everyone, fat hen, nutgrass, pigweed. So things like fat hen, really the key issue there, come on mouse, is that it seeds very quickly. So it grows quickly. It's quite a tall and spread out plant, so it's very good at creating competition against the crop. Seeds very quickly and produces many, many, many seeds. So fat hen falls into that first group of the rapid and heavy seeders. Same with pigweed. Again, it's got a lot of seeds, can contaminate crops, reduce yield, and very quick to seed, and off they go. The seeds in the soil bank, again, the seed bank, and creating problems for future years. So there are a couple of examples of that sort of thing. Then we've got a really notorious one is nutgrass. So it's got the underground parts, which are not really effectively controlled by tillage, and often not effectively controlled by herbicides as well. And here we can see not even controlled by plastic mulch, which is generally fine against a lot of the heavy seeding annuals. So they're the real problem ones. And then we might think, well, how do we manage them in an IWM, integrated weed management program? What sort of strategies are important? What principles can we apply about knowing the plant and so on? So we'll just have questions at the end and just keep going on through. So over to you, Marc, now, just for your experience on this sort of area of IWM too.
Okay, thanks, Paul. We appreciate Paul's expertise in helping us. This is part of the Integrated Crop Protection Project, and I'd just like to re-emphasize the integrated weed control. We all probably know chemical the best, but some of these things that we can do leading up to using chemical can help reduce the weed seed bank, and that's really the goal, to help the chemicals work, to keep them working, and get the best out of them. So I just hygiene, I've seen a few weeds introduced in transplants that come on the farm, so just be aware of that. Vehicle tires, there's some weeds like cocky weed and catheads that are notorious for sticking to tires, and you can spread them around the country in a hurry. Be aware of fence lines and borders. It's good hygiene to keep them from going to seed and blowing into your paddocks, but they tend to be a source of resistance, especially glyphosate resistance coming into farms. And irrigation water can be a source of weeds, birds. Cultural practices would be things like crop rotation, but really do everything you can to disadvantage the weeds. And banding, placing fertilizer under the crop and not feeding the weeds is a cultural practice. Good sowing conditions and hybrid weed seed, hybrid vigor that can help the crop compete against the weeds early. Mechanical use of farm equipment, tillage, slashing, mowing may or may not be a place. Biological is probably not so much used in horticulture. There's a stem boring beetle used in Patterson's curse, and sometimes sheep and goats can be used to eat weeds. So, and then there's chemical. We'll get to that later. But I just mentioned new and emerging technologies that are quickly changing the game. Robotics, drones, and in other parts of the world, in horticulture, GM herbicide tolerance technology is a big thing. I rang a friend back in Idaho where I was from on wanting a herbicide or a weed control program for beets, and I says, what's your program? And he says, Roundup. And I says, no, what's your program? He says, Roundup. I says, you don't have any conventional beets left? He says, nope. So that was kind of interesting. Okay, Paul.
Great. Thank you very much, Marc. And on that biological, yeah, biologicals are good in perennial stable systems where so for fruit trees or environmental weeds and so on. In vegetable production, you've got such a dynamic system. There's annual crops and, two or three crops a year and so on. So there's not really a good opportunity for the hosts to develop and to sort of make a home and build up their populations and then go out and control the weeds or even if for insect biocontrol programs. So things like in glasshouses, there's some of that. So yeah, it's a very dynamic system. But all those other points, very important. And so many cultural things, like picking the crop to suit the weed load and thinking about your row spacings and densities and trying to advantage the crop in terms of where you're applying your water and fertilizers and so on. So thanks, Marc. So that's sort of really what integrated weed management is. There's a whole lot of things, and it's about juggling them and having a plan and then implementing that plan. So let's go through some of the specifics and think about how they may fit into an IWM program, not just my program's Roundup. So farm hygiene. So, yeah, you really want to stop the seeds from coming onto the farm, first of all. So having some sort of higher security, so you can come to the office first and those sort of things for people delivering supplies and whatnot. So they've probably potentially come from other farms. So really what's arriving at the farm, having some farm gate biosecurity. And then you also want to be thinking within your property, what are the areas that are heavily infested versus the ones that are less so, and how are you going to move between those in what order and what you'll do with your machinery and so on. So having a dedicated washdown area, quarantine area where all the seeds get washed into there, and then you've got a really focused area to control those weeds, and certainly limiting spread around the farm. So always starting on the cleanest paddock, and then working your way through to the most weed infested. So farm hygiene, it really is the starting point, and in a sense the ending point, and all along the way for integrated weed management. So farm hygiene is critical. So just to jump back, and because seeds are really the big thing, seeds and also the tubers, but that's what's driving it all. It's not so much the weeds that you can see, it's all those ones lurking under the ground. And another at the planning stage, planning crop rotation. So that's obviously got an economic side to it. Who are you contracted to grow for and what's required and all those things. So there's constraints to how flexible you can be with crop rotations. But generally the principles are to vary the crops that you're growing. And have different families, so they have different timings. So when they want to be planted, how long the season is, and all those things sort of break up the patterns so that the weeds and also pests and diseases are being disadvantaged. We're not creating this sort of regular environment or regular conditions for them to then fit in and suits their lifestyle or their life cycle. So having different families over time, so in the carrot families, so Apiaceae, lettuce in the daisy family, and then brassicas and cucurbits and so on, so Solanaceae. So they're all going to bring you along a different suite of weeds and other baddies. So changing that as much as your economic situation will allow is beneficial. These also allow for different weeding methods. So, you know, not all of them will be the same. The sort of ploughing you're using, the herbicides you're using, the cultural methods and so on will all start to vary. So not just varying the crop, but varying the management operations starts to, again, break up the patterns and make it difficult for particularly problematic weeds to get established. And so, well, it knocks out the easy ones more easily and harder for the problematic ones. And there's also these indirect benefits of crop rotation. You know, we all know about for pests and diseases, not creating, you know, continuing sort of host for pests and diseases to live there. So breaking those disease cycles. And usually it's benefiting the soil as well. So there we're not extracting nutrients from the soil of one type with one sort of root structure. So plants may have different root architecture and different nutritional needs. So by varying that over time, we're actually benefiting the soil too, along with other sort of management programs like, as I talked about, I think some cover cropping and other bits and pieces. A key thing that farmers are doing both before and during the cropping sort of season is tillage, so the bed preparation. They're doing things like the stale seed beds, letting prepare the beds, let a cohort of weeds come up, and then just tickle them off with a scuffler or some sort of or some scarifier, a very shallow sort of tillage, and that can really quickly reduce the number of seeds in the seed bank or weed seeds in the seed bank, and then allow you to plant the crop with a competitive advantage. So those sort of things, good preparation. Other sort of technologies coming out now, and there's a lot of this is about some good engineering. Some of it's in Europe, there's little bits in Australia. So this is the Weed Fix tool, then Mark Fix Engineering in Dalesford, near Dalesford. So he's got these vertical tines that spin along next to the row of crop. And they've got some little shields in the middle. It's front mounted on the tractor, so you've got very good steering and very good accuracy. And they can be very good for once your crop's starting to get established to get in and you know, maybe do one pass with that, and that might be enough, or one or two. So these sort of innovations in new tillage gear, not just the old chisel plough and so on. So yeah, tillage obviously a key strategy. Something we want to think about is in veggies is not much no-till, so that's a whole new sort of question that's the broadacre farmers have been onto for a while, and where will that head for vegetable growers is an interesting question. So mulch, so we've got plastic mulches, also things like organic-based mulches, but a bit expensive, hard to apply, but they have soil benefits. So very effective, so they're very good also for the other benefits like water conservation, sometimes burning off some or sort of solarising some diseases and other pests and so on. So yeah, very effective for weed control, sort of easy to apply with the right gear, and then really can control, you know, most weeds, particularly those heavy seeding annuals. Some obviously like nut grass are not controlled by that. It does have the problem of the waste disposal at the end, so that's sort of a bit of an issue potentially. So plastic mulch, again, for many crops is a very viable sort of option. And also reduces spoilage like splash, and that's splash only for the crop, but also to avoid diseases being splashed up into the canopy as well. Hand weeding, expensive but effective, or effective but expensive. So yep, and that's a good sort of maybe a last resort or towards the end when you haven't been able to do it through cultural or mechanical and chemical methods, then hand weeding can really get in and get those last ones out, and particularly to prevent seeding of those last few. So those last few may not be a problem for in terms of yield reduction for the crop, but they may be in terms of giving you a headache for next year. So hand weeding and that diligence aspect, persistence and diligence. Cover crops, so again, we're thinking big picture about the farming system. Having cover crops in the system, they have other benefits for soil and so on, for building soil, but also can be effective in where you might have a heavy load of weeds. These things can suppress those weeds. So they can come in through and will be effective through physical competition, physical processes, so very quick growing ones that make a dense cover and outcompete any of the weeds. are very good. Sometimes they're legumes, or often they might be sort of grass-based things like ryegrass or other cereals. The physical competition also, they may have sort of chemical effects by fumigation. So, and they're releasing chemicals that can suppress weeds, but only certain weeds, not everything. And so again, they're an effective way to reduce some of the weeds. So a lot of the brassicas, so various turnips, mustards and radishes, so on, have been sold. Caliente, I think, is one in Tassie, but many are around the place now. The issue, though, with cover crops is that, economic, so the lost income, the opportunity cost, and in some regions, sort of peri-urban areas of Sydney and Melbourne, they're not, you know, they're sowing one crop after another and don't have time for things like fallowing with stale seed beds or cover crops. So there's that lost income, which is a real issue. And then poor establishment. If you don't get a good cover crop establishment, you're actually creating a little home for a whole lot more weeds, and their seeds will come as well. So you've got to be able to manage it and get good establishment and get that good cover. Terminating them, if it's a very vigorous cover crop, how do you terminate it? So here's some sort of non-chemical methods, rollers and crimpers, but also just spraying them off with a knockdown. And if they're very vigorous, we don't want them to become weeds themselves in the next crop. So a useful tool, but you know, requires fair bit of management skills. So a lot of other methods as well. Biodegradable mulch is becoming important in terms of that waste management for plastic mulch. Still, there's a bit of research going on here in Australia and in Europe. I would think that there's some reasonable products around. There's still some issues, but probably within the medium term, we might see some fairly reliable products when we get out, you know, the chemistry of these plastics and films or biodegradable materials better. Thermal weeding is sort of another option. It has the benefit of being able to, particularly with things like stale seed beds, letting the cohort come up, and then you go when they're still young, burning them off with either steam or flame or hot water. Generally steam tends to be one of the more effective ones. So it's preventing further soil disturbance, but it's expensive and it's also selective. So that steam tends to, or the thermal methods, for things like for grassy weeds, they've got a hidden growth point inside the grass, whereas broadleafs have exposed growth points. So once the weed gets a little bit older, it's not going to be too effective against those older grasses. It may be okay for the broadleafs. So it's so you've got to get it at the right time. Stale, false seed beds, so that's letting the weeds come up and knocking them down either through herbicide or a shallow tillage is okay if you've got the time and the bank manager's not banging on the door. And a few other things, solarisation as well. So there's a few things. So back over to Marc. Oh, no, sorry. One more for me. So herbicides, obviously they're a mainstay, and they're generally very effective, and they're versatile, and whether they're pre-emergent or post-emergent. So obviously that's a key part of what we do, but hopefully your reliance on them is less if all the other parts are working in your integrated weed management program. And again, coming back to that issue of, so the gaps in the herbicide availability. So again, we've got broadleaf crops, which vegetables are mostly, and then we've got broadleaf weeds in particular. So there's a real issue with that of having available herbicides for all the different crops and possibly needing minor use permits and so on. So that's there as well as a key tool. So, all right, now we're over to Marc again.
Okay, Paul mentioned that hand weeding is very expensive, and I think that's very true, especially in Australia with high labor costs. So I just thought I'd mention robotics. Sydney University's had their robotics out to Cowra, and where I work, and some of the comments on that has been that, you know, they can work long hours. They can achieve excellent results, and with minimal crop effect or liability. So they're just one of the things they're working on is just shooting out maybe a bit of concentrated liquid form of nitrogen, like ammonium nitrate or ammonium thiosulfate, and taking out weeds that way. So it's just an interesting technology. Some of it's out of Germany that can recognize leaf shape and near infrared to locate and identify weeds. Okay, next slide, Paul. Now this is leading up to the use of herbicides. So the idea is that you've done everything you can to reduce the weed seed bank in the paddock, and just a comment prior, probably mostly around residual herbicides, and that's that reduced tillage does tend to help the weeds stay in the top zone, and that's a better, that gives the advantage. Residual herbicides generally work better when they're closer to the weed seeds. And then Paul mentioned cover crops and this business of stubble tie-up can be quite a concern sometimes. There's I just mentioned maybe group J's, group K's, and group D's are all fairly notorious for having problems tying up on stubble. Things like Eptam and Avidex, Dual, Ramrod, Stomp, Pendimethalin. So I think you're probably all pretty much aware of that. But shifting the growing season, depending on where you're at in Australia, but sometimes that can help get a different hit on certain winter weeds versus summer weeds and that idea. And then Paul mentioned earlier just this idea of disadvantaging the weeds, advantaging the crop. And if you can consider sowing the cleanest paddocks in the difficult establishment seasons, because those are going to be your dirtier paddocks. So.
Yeah, good one. Thanks very much, Marc. All right, so we're just about to wrap up. We'll just come back to the end, and then we can open up for questions. I just want to sort of re-stress the key messages, really, that we've sort of hopefully getting people aware of. So, and a lot of it's about the planning, the doing, and reviewing. As Marc sort of pointed out, really the key is managing the weed seed bank. That's the goal. There can be so many thousand plants above ground, but there could be tens of thousands of seeds underground. And knowing what's the how long do they live and so on is important. So managing that weed seed bank. Planning, doing, and reviewing. And that can be for this season, or for this crop in this season. It can be for a year. It can be for 2 or 3 years. And having a plan. And then you implement it, you start, and then you look back and think, well, what happened? You know, what was successful in terms of my different methods? What areas the infestation was worse than other areas on the farm or in that paddock? Looking back and then reviewing it and then modifying your plan for the next season. So I'm sure that's sort of, it's a natural process, but having the main thing is to have a plan and then to keep that plan reasonably flexible. Again, you know, depending on the economics and what crops are going to be earning money, but then thinking about that diversity and these sort of issues. So, yep, diversity, avoiding the patterns, weeds, pest diseases, all love patterns. So having different cropping options, different strategies, rotating what you're doing, not relying on one thing. Relying on one thing gives really strong selection pressure for certain things and not others. So, yep. Keep it, I think I read somewhere a long time ago, many small hammers is one sort of idea. So multiple strategies. Hygiene is very important. As I sort of said earlier, it's the start and end of what you're doing. Don't let them come on and then be very careful with where those seeds end up. So, yep, it's all about the seeds and where they're going and not letting them move around the farm any more than is possible. And then finally, the diligence, so being onto it, doing things at the right time. And so really, a stitch in time saves 9, but in this case, 9,000, so many. So So they're kind of the key messages. Just quickly before we go to questions, just some acknowledgements. So certainly, you know, thanks, and we always enjoy getting out of the office and going out to talk to vegetable farmers all across Australia with my colleagues. So, you know, we hope to continue doing that, and thanks for all that sort of input and advice. Regional contacts, so that help us get, you know, link up with grower groups in various places all over Australia. The webinar team, so Marc, Kelvin and Liam doing the IT stuff, thanks very much. And Hort Innovation, so Ben Callahan and some of the others in terms of giving us sort of feedback and ideas and how we can sort of make what we do, you know, well targeted to the farmers and other stakeholders. And then the other groups as well, so the companies. Okay, so back to here, and I'm going to hand it back now to Kelvin to sort of facilitate questions.
Thanks, Paul, and Marc for that presentation. Just a few questions coming in, so please add in some more as we're talking. The first question's around, you know, Paul's talked about some of the key weeds there, but what happens when you see a weed that you don't recognise? Marc, do you want to run through the sort of logic of what you'd do?
Well, there are a few apps that you can take a picture and compare it right on your iPad or iPhone or whatever, and sometimes you can identify it that way. You can take, if you can find different growth stages of the weed and take it into your local agronomist, you can find some help there sometimes. And I guess if it's a real curly one and nobody in the district knows what it is, you send it to experts like Paul. Paul, do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, that's right. I think, you know, there's a lot of things you can do. These days you can bring the expert to your home through the internet and things, so that's really great. And but it's sometimes a bit hard to look for a picture, unlike a word. So you start with your own little home research, then go out to your local community, who you're buying your supplies off, produce stores and so on. If you have a district agronomist, good luck. Go and talk to them with one of your DPIs or ag departments, or commercial agronomists. And then, yeah, if you're still not having any luck, then you could talk to various unis. So there's quite a few weed groups still at uni, so here at UNE, Charles Sturt Uni, Wagga Wagga, up at, well, Toowoomba, they've got a very strong weed group, and then Uni of Adelaide, Tassie. So, yeah, they're spread around. Talk to them. The other sort of, if it was really difficult, that we wouldn't know, then we might actually send it off to a herbarium. But then it would be something that's pretty rare and, yeah, not well known. So, you know, herbariums possibly as a last resort.
Thanks, Paul. Another question comes down to weed resistance to herbicides, and obviously it's a major issue in broadacre. I wonder, Marc, if you could just comment on how relevant it is to weeds in the veg sector.
We've had a few workshops, spray application workshops with Scott Matthew Syngenta, and this was his comment, which I thought was very interesting, that Australia uses only about 3% of the world's herbicides, but Australia is second highest in number of resistant weeds. And that's probably largely in broadacre, I realize that, but it is a certainly a factor. I think in horticulture, what I would be very suspect of getting resistance is the group A fops and dims. We were relying heavily on like clethodim in my area, and the Wimmera annual ryegrass is notoriously resistant to a lot of it, and yeah, it's certainly a concern.
So just one particular group? And
Yeah, there can be cross resistance, and there's the Herbicide Resistance Action Committee. You can look on their website, and there's scientists worldwide communicating with each other and developing strategies against resistance. But I'm just saying, Group A's would be my first suspect.
So to summarize it, it's the reason why we're not seeing widespread herbicide resistance is because in veggie production we tend to have used multiple strategies. So you know, you often see people out there still with the hoe.
Yeah, I would say so. Paul, you want to comment on that?
Yeah. I think, and I saw there's a question from Marco Montagna. Is there a plan to conduct surveys to understand resistance status in weeds in vegetables? As far as I know, there's very little information, certainly in Australia, on the level of herbicide resistance. And it may be that because the broadacre farmers have gone to sort of no-till, and they're very dependent, you know, they're focusing their strategy on herbicides, and that's potentially really creating selective pressure. In vegetables, because there's such a use of tillage, then that may be actually delaying or preventing the development of herbicide resistance. So, and other strategies as well, there's the use of plastic. So vegetables is much more intensive, and the opportunity is different techniques is there than you might not have if you've got a sort of a really big broadacre property, you know, several thousand hectares. So it's possibly been an advantage. But in terms of Marco's question, I would, you know, it'd be great to start to look at that, to look at herbicide resistance, just to quantify it, and maybe we've got some good news, or you know, there's some patches of bad news, and we manage that. So it's, yeah, important question.
So in summary, Paul, there are no current surveys across the Hort sector in terms of weed resistance?
No. I'm just looking at my colleagues who are with me who have conducted some of the other work, and no, nothing that we're aware of. So I've just put over in chat the AHRI, the Australian Herbicide Resistance Initiative. So they're a group, I think, based in Uni of Western Australia. They do a lot of work on herbicide resistance. Chris Preston at Adelaide Uni as well, but it's all the broadacre stuff. It's you know, canola and wheat and things. So I don't know, and it would be not that hard to start to unpick some of those things. So yeah, not known. I'm not sure about overseas whether we know much about vegetable systems and these sort of small-scale, intensive, rotational sort of systems that veggies normally are. Are they a problem overseas as well in terms of resistance? Not sure.
Okay. Thanks, Paul. We've got a specific question here, so I might try this first to Marc. A problem with common ground sow and rockets, leeks and celery. Have we found any effect of herbicides?
Common ground sow and...
in celery and yeah, rocket and leeks.
Can you tell me, Paul?
Do you know much about common ground sow?
Okay. I'm not sure about the effect of herbicides, but the common thing about those three crops you've got there, so ground sow, yeah, grows pretty tall and has a lot of seeds and so on. So leeks and celery, rockets, they're all pretty small. They're sort of narrow. They're not competitive crops, so they're going to be very susceptible to weeds. So if you've got problematic weeds, you know, having them in other areas or growing them in places with less ground cell, maybe, I don't know how much land you've got and that's an option, but they're all quite vulnerable weeds. Vulnerable crops. So rocket, very little canopy. And then leeks and celery, the same issue. So I would think that, trying to get that weed seed bank down of ground cell, it may be through some strategic tillage beforehand, that sort of stale seedbed approach. Possibly trying to increase the plant density, so the row spacings, those sorts of things. I can't really comment on the herbicides. I might leave that to Marc to comment on if he's... got any ideas there. But again, it's they're not competitive crops, so they're always going to be vulnerable. And so having paddocks that have less of these problematic weeds is the starting point. Then try to maximise the that competitive capacity through potentially row spacings or the stale seed bed, trying to reduce those seed numbers.
It's that pre-plant cultural practices to set up your paddock before you even put your crop in there, and a key when you don't have a range.
Yeah, well, and herbicides too, but I just couldn't give any specific information about those.
Yeah. Which ones? I'll have to research it. Yeah. We'll get back to that.
So nothing off the top of the head, but we'll post. Mark will look into that and put something.
Yeah.
We've got a question here regarding the use of permanent beds in vegetable production. So that increasingly growers are moving towards that controlled traffic permanent beds, and guess the participants wanting to canvass the views whether that's going to improve weed control or make it worse. Paul?
Okay, yeah, so I think that'll be good for a whole range of other things, but I'm not sure that'll be good for weeds. I know one of the big herbicide resistant guys, he said when you go to that thing, you don't get less weeds, you just get different weeds. And what it'll do, it'll push it away from those sort of heavy seeding annuals to some of the more persistent, sort of longer-lived biennial perennial ones. In sort of the no-till system, things have come up like fleabane and sow thistle, which tend to sort of don't get well controlled by herbicides per se, and then they've got good roots and they can persist over time and still put out a lot of seed. So I think permanent beds have a lot of benefits for sort of other aspects, but in terms of some of your crop protection issues like diseases building up, having a regular environment to be able to thrive. And I think it's a really good idea. It's efficient in terms of your water and nutrient inputs and so on, and your labour as well. But it may have effects on the seed bank, but it will probably shift your weed suite from purely sort of annual stuff to a bit more perennial sort of stuff. So, yeah. So a good idea for other reasons, but I don't know. Yeah, that'll universally help weed control. Any other comments from
yours? Just a couple other follow-ups from the. From the resistance aspect, we just wanted to point out that crop life is a good source of information for the managing your resistance, herbicide resistance. Mark, do you want to just...
It's somebody typed in crop life, and I think it's all tied in with the Herbicide Resistance Action Committee that I mentioned earlier, so... I'm just looking at it, and they categorize the different groups, which are the different modes of action, into high resistance risk, moderate resistance risk, and low resistance risk. So it's a fairly generalization, but they have both group A's and group B's in high resistance, and then group C's, group D, E, F, G, they all drop into the moderate resistance risk. And this is Crop Life Australia. This is specific to Australia.
So I've sent around a link, and thanks for Ben for providing that. So if you want more information on that resistance. There's a few other just points to make. There's obviously now the... where am I? Sorry, I'm losing my track of things here. So there's now the National Vegetable Extension Program, and that will be a good source of potential information at a local level. And I know our Victorian colleagues are looking at potentially running some weed control sessions around Victoria around those. So keep an eye out for that. There's also, as I said at the beginning, the Integrated Crop Protection Program has put out that fact sheet,
And I think the email that was sent around with the link to this webinar had a connection or a link to that fact sheet. So I might just pass it over to Paul, if you want to just provide a final wrap-up, and then Mark.
Yeah. One thing that just occurred to me, and it's sort of a good point at this stage, is that IWM, and particularly in terms of the workshops and other sort of sources of information, these days there is plenty of info on the web, and that's great. But one of the key things about IWM is that it's very site specific. So it's even down to your farm, you know, certainly in terms of your region, the neighbourhood, you know, we'll have common types of where you'll have common crops and common climatic conditions, common soils and so on. And that's different to other regions. So it's very site specific, even what machinery you've got, how, you know, how much your workload is, you know, if you're fully on farm or you're distracted by other activities in the supply chain or whatever. So one of the, I suppose, disadvantages is the complexity of having the integrated approach. It's not something you can just pick off the shelf and apply. So whereas sort of particular strategies you can do that. So heading down that path, trying those different sort of processes, I think is important, so that we don't get so you're not selecting for particular weeds, whether they're resistant or not. You can have tillage resistant weeds as well as herbicide resistant weeds and things. So keeping it diverse, keep breaking those patterns, I think are important. There was just one question popped up. Which key weeds are not controlled with biofumigation? I'm not sure off the top of my head. I did a bit of work myself with biofumigation, and I didn't specifically look at the weeds. Which species and so on. I just know from a lot of other research that that the chemicals that are released are not going to affect every type of weed that's there. It's just, you know, there's some plants are more sensitive. They've done a lot of work, even not just with brassica biofumigants, but also things coming out of barley and so chemicals exuded by barley and sorghum. They're also potentially allelopathic, suppressing the germination and growth of other plants. But yeah, I couldn't sort of say specifically, but any of those chemicals are never going to be getting every weed. So it's just the nature of it. And I guess that brings another principle of IWM. You know, the idea is not that any one tool is 100% perfect all the time. It's about mixing it up and having different options. So that allelopathic biofumigation approach will control some, tillage may do others, and herbicides others again, and that sort of thing. So, yeah.
Thanks, Paul. There's just a couple of other questions coming in, so we might, given that we're still under an hour. Just a question to Marc in regard to the technology of robotics. He was just asking about what trials have been undertaken to date on farm.
Well, out in the Cara area, they've had the robotics out on the baby leaf spinach crop. And I suppose the farmer interest in robotics on that crop is that it's very sensitive to herbicides. Really, it's all the integrated weed management principles and stale seed bed and pre-emergent herbicides is our strategy with baby leaf spinach, and we don't like to use any herbicides post. So if you have a few escapes and a few weeds in a baby leaf spinach crop at about the caudaling to two leaf stage, when before the crop canopy comes over and the weeds are very small and easily identifiable and reached by the robot as it comes across, it can squirt a bit down and do a very effective job without hurting. So it's like I mentioned, some crops probably lend themselves better to robotics. I'm not an expert on robotics by any means, but just firsthand, that's the one trial I've seen.
So in terms of how far off they are from actually being practical tools for weed management, what's your guess?
I don't know. You'd have to ask that. I think the technology's there. It's probably the economics. I think the one they've got available to go to work now is about $100,000, I think they told me. What size of a tank and how they get their costs back and market it, I don't know. But
there's certainly a lot of work going into those autonomous vehicles from some of the big companies, and also the sensors and control systems going on them. So it's certainly obviously something in the sort of 5 to 10 year horizon. I don't think it'll be around. It'll be released at the next field day or within the next year, but it's certainly something to keep an eye on. We had one general comment, maybe Paul, I'll put this one to you in terms of a good reference for integrated weed management. Where would you go to for more detailed information?
Thanks. So that's from Claire Russell, reference book for the most comprehensive and useful. That's why I was looking on my bookshelf. There was something that came out of, and I forget her surname, Mary something from Florida. In Australia, there's really nothing, and again, that's one of the jobs that needs to be done is to compile that. There's reasonable resources for the grains, so GLEC and cotton, for IWM, and the principles are similar. So that's a job that needs doing, really, to compile that. And I'm happy with my colleagues. We can maybe just knock up a short list of resources that we think are possibly useful, mostly some web links and maybe a couple of books and so on. So, yeah, there's not really a definitive book on IWM in vegetable cropping. So, work to be done. I just also, while I've got the mic, a couple of good comments from Noel Stevens. Knowing all your weeds, sample them, identify them, understand their life cycle, soil temp, leaf type and so on. Really important, didn't mention it, and yeah, know thy enemy. I did talk a bit about traits, but know the specific weed is really critical, and knowing its life cycle, its sort of ecology is very important. Noel also mentioned boom spray effectiveness, so there's a couple of points there. And a suggestion about shield spraying in celery for controlling ground cells. So a couple of good contributions there as well. So.
People are waking up.
Did you want to talk about, there was the comment about boom spraying there. Did you want to comment about that, Mark, at all or not? Or there's some good principles there.
I'm probably just going to put it back to Mark just for a quick comment on the biofumigation. As we were just having a chat, we have been involved with some of our soil wealth sites, soil wealth ICP sites, in terms of biofumigation.
Paul mentioned earlier, it's not a silver bullet. It's never going to get 100% of the weeds. And the principles of fumigation are really in place, and that is it's most effective on respiring weed seeds. So they've been subject to moisture for some time, softened, and it probably lends itself to, I find it's the weeds that are in the top few centimeters are the ones that are going to be best controlled. I get the least, I see weeds coming from depth, often following either biofumigation or methane sodium. So things like black oats will come from depth after a solid fumigation just because they're coming from depth. Yeah, so I've certainly seen a reduction in weeds from biofumigation.
Thanks, Mark. We might just start to wrap it up. So just want to thank you all for joining the Integrated Crop Protection webinar. Just remind you of the recording that will be available from the webinar in about a week's time. So I think that will go out in the updates, the weekly updates that the project's put out. Want to thank Paul up there in UNE and his team for
for bringing the report to life. I think it was about a 250-page report, Paul, so I think listening to a webinar is a far easier way to digest it. Also, thanks to Marc for bringing along his sort of more practical agronomic type views, and Liam for keeping the technology on track. So thanks to everyone for attending, and keep an eye out for the next webinar.
Great. Yeah, thanks everyone. And I don't think my email was somewhere, but if you want to get in contact with the ICP guys and if you want to continue the chat, so it's very good and very interesting, and clearly some of you people know as much as us, so thanks very much.
Thanks, Paul.
Thanks, folks.